Yes, hello everyone. Yes, somebody please ping me. Am I audible? Good evening, Jayashri. Yes, thanks, Jayashri. Good evening, Rituparna. Good evening, Harmeet. Good evening, Bharati. Yes, somebody please ping me if I'm audible so that I can start the session. Okay, thank you. Good evening, Monisha. Hello, everyone. Welcome to Unacademy, India's largest online learning platform. Let's crack UPSC CSE English. Now, before I start the session, let me introduce myself for the people who are new on the platform. My name is Alok Ojha. I have done my engineering from Pune. I have been associated with the field of UPSC since past 6 to 6.5 years. I hold the experience of giving CDS SSB twice. I also hold the experience of exams like CAPF Assistant Commandant and Uttar Pradesh PSC. I have been through various stages of civil services exam. I'm involved into the field of teaching since past 4 to 4.5 years. And I've mentored more than 10,000 students for UPSC. Now, before I start with again a very important topic today, that is Muttiman Committee, Simon Commission and Butler Committee, let me introduce the platform in short. Like, there might be question in the mind of an aspirant why one should prefer Unacademy as a platform for online learning. So here are the ample of reasons why one should prefer Unacademy as a platform for online learning. First of all, you'll have daily live classes on the Unacademy platform. Unacademy offers you assimilation of top and dynamic educators of India on a single platform. You can directly interact with the educators. You can clear all sorts of doubts with the educators. Second most important aspect is building up competence or competitiveness. Now, why competence or competitiveness is important? Let us understand with the help of a small example. Each year, approximately around 8 to 9 lakh forms are being filled up for UPSC, out of which 3 to 4 lakh appear for the prelims exam. 10 to 11,000 qualify the prelims exam. 3 to 4,000 qualify the mains exam. And finally, 800 to 1,000 odd make into the final list. So if I filter it down, one aspirant is competing with 800 to 900 other aspirant. And in that case, he needs to build up that sort of competence or competitiveness. Why? Because an aspirant is not only competing with fellow aspirants in the district, he's competing on pan-India basis. He's competing at all India level. That is why competence is necessary. And Unacademy helps you to build up your competence by going through live tests and quizzes. Then all the courses on an Unacademy platform are highly structured in nature, and there is a proper timetable through which the courses are being conducted, and one can have unlimited access to the courses on an Unacademy platform. Here are the few top and dynamic educators of India from whom you're going to learn through. These are the courses being offered on the Unacademy platform. Subscribe to Unacademy and use my code AKOUS. I repeat the code AKOUS. Now, there is also something called as Iconic Subscription. Now, what is Iconic Subscription all about? Let me explain this in short again. Like, basically, if you are a beginner, basically, and you are preparing for civil services, now, there might be many aspirants whose preparation might be directionless because they cannot analyze the preparation right from the start itself. Like what strategy needs to be chalked down, what resources should be used, how much time should be dedicated to a particular subject, how NCERT should be read, how much time should be dedicated to current affairs, how much time should be dedicated to reading the newspaper basically. So there would be a mentor who would be guiding you throughout your journey for civil services preparation. And that is nothing but Iconic Subscription. So if you choose me as your mentor, please use my code AKOUS. I repeat the code AKOUS. Good evening, Kalai. Good evening, Prerna. Good evening, Sarfaraz. Good evening, Vaishali. Good evening, Chahat. Good evening, Kiruba. Good evening, Shipra. Good evening, Aisha. Good evening, Shashank. Good evening, Royal. Good evening, Prerna. Yes, guys. So, before I start today's session, let me give you a small information, guys. Like those students who have missed out my Ancient India lectures. Okay, these lectures are available on the YouTube. Secondly, tomorrow as a part of special class, I'm conducting again a session on Mauryas. And that session would be starting at 9:15 a.m. in the morning on the Unacademy platform as a part of special class. So those guys who have missed my lectures previously, basically, they can, attend the lectures basically. Okay. Good evening, Aisha. Yes, Royal Girl, you can ask me the question. Now, before I begin up with the Muddiman committee, let me give you a brief background of yesterday's lecture just within 2 to 3 minutes. Now, please pay attention carefully because students who are attending my session for the first time, they can easily understand the concepts. They can easily understand what we had discussed earlier. Now, what is basically Muddiman committee? Before that, we are going to discuss certain important facts. Now, non-cooperation movement, the call for non-cooperation movement basically was given around 1920. And before one of the major demands that was put before the Britishers, before launching the non-cooperation movement was that first of all, Britishers should show regret for what had happened in Punjab. I had already talked about one event that occurred in Punjab that is called as Jallianwala Bagh massacre. Like in Jallianwala Bagh massacre, it is said that people were peacefully protesting against the arrest of their leader, that is Dr. Satyapal and Dr. Saifuddin Kichlo. Dr. Satyapal and Dr. Saifuddin Kichlo were initially protesting, were initially carrying out Hartal in Amritsar. For what? They were carrying out Hartal against the Rowlatt attack. Now, these leaders were basically arrested by the Britishers. Now, the people gathered in Jallianwala Bagh, and General Dyer, without analyzing the situation, without directly speaking with the peaceful protester, started open firing on these people. More than 15,000 people were caught under the hails of bullets. The firing did not stop till 15 to 17 minutes. Or we can say that firing only stopped when the ammunition was completely over. So basically it is said, when the ammunition got over. So this event in the entire history of modern India is referred as Jallianwala Bagh massacre. And we have discussed this event in quite depth when we have studied Jallianwala Bagh massacre. As per official records, 376 people were killed. But unofficially, more than thousands of people were massacred during the Jallianwala Bagh massacre. There was one more event which was going at this time, that is Khilafat movement. Now, what is Khilafat movement? Basically, it is said that Turkey, during the World War I, Turkey was on opposite side of Britain. Now, Britain won the World War I and it started imposing harsh terms and conditions on the rulers of Turkey. Now, basically, it is said Turkey was captured by Britain. Now, the ruler of the Turkey was also referred as Caliph, and Caliph was the religious head of all the Sunni Muslims in the world. Now, Britain decided to overthrow the position of Caliph. Okay? Now, Britain decided to overthrow the position of Caliph. This completely hurted the sentiments of Muslims all over India, all over the world. And now, basically, they decided that what did we get initially? Like, as I've told you, Muslim League right from the start was supportive to the policies of the Britishers. Why? Because they believed that if we remain loyal to the Britishers, some or the other day, Britishers are going to repay for our loyalty. But this did not happen. So what happened basically? A movement was started against the British and this is called as Khilafat movement. So now basically one of the other demand was Britishers should restore the position of Caliph. So majorly the two demands were restoration of the position of Caliph and basically the Britishers should show regret for what had happened in Punjab. Britishers did not listen to any of the demands of the Congress. And now Congress under the leadership of M.K. Gandhi initiated the non-cooperation movement. Now, it is said that the non-cooperation movement right from the start was based upon twin principles. One was non-violence and the other was Satyagraha. The term Satyagraha had been coined by M.K. Gandhi in South Africa. And Satyagraha, Satyagraha. Try to break this etymology in two parts. Satya plus Agraha. Satya means truth. And Agraha basically means polite insistence. Nobody can force us to speak the truth. Isn't that so? Until and unless it comes from within. So that is one of the quality of a Satyagrahi. What is a quality? Even though if there is a lot of pressure on you, even though if there is a lot of violence activities being conducted against you, you should be honest in your path. You should be honest towards your goal and mash your goal basically. That is one of the quality of a Satyagrahi. So during non-cooperation movement, Swadeshi was also accepted and Khadi became the symbol of the people. Non-cooperation movement was quite successful throughout the entire India except Bombay Presidency. Why? Because in Bombay Presidency, people were mourning the death of their favorite leader, whose name was Bal Gangadhar Tilakji. And M.K. Gandhi initiated a fund in the name of Bal Gangadhar Tilak. That is Tilak Swaraj Fund. And just with the name of this fund, rupees 1 crore were collected in just 6 months. Just in the name of Tilakji. So, it is said that the movement also took up pace in the Bombay Presidency after that. Now, the movement was quite successful by 1922. Now, everyone decided that non-cooperation movement should now be converted into civil disobedience movement. Now, what is the difference between non-cooperation and civil disobedience? Non-cooperation, as the name itself suggests, we are not going to cooperate with the Britishers. In very simple words, suppose if the Britishers are making government schools and colleges, and if I am a student, I am not going to attend these government schools and colleges. If Britishers are making law codes, and if I am a lawyer, I am not going to attend the law codes basically. So what will happen basically here? I am not cooperating with the Britishers. And civil disobedience, what does that mean? Civil disobedience means breaking the laws which I feel are curtailing my fundamental rights. Breaking the laws which I feel are curtailing the civil liberties. That is civil disobedience. So many leaders of the Congress decided that non-cooperation is very successful. So we should convert this non-cooperation into civil disobedience. But what one incident shook the entire nation. And this was not accepted by M.K. Gandhi because many leaders have criticized this act. What happened? This incident is called as Chauri Chaura incident. Now, Chauri Chaura is a small village in Gorakhpur district of Uttar Pradesh. Now, the people in this region were peacefully protesting in front of the liquor shop against the high prices, against the inflation, against the unemployment and various issues, basically against the Britishers. Now, few Britishers started doing lathi charge on the people. After that, they started open firing on the people. Now, the movement took a violent turn. Now, Britishers basically said that the people who were peacefully protesting gathered and put these policemen into a police station. And they torched the entire police station. They burnt the entire police station and it is said that 22 policemen were burnt in this and they died. Like it is said that policemen, there were many policemen who came out of the police station to save their life and were running away. But the mob caught them again and they put them back again into the police station. Now, basically, M.K. Gandhi withdrew the non-cooperation movement because M.K. Gandhi based his movement completely on Satyagraha and non-violence. But this was an act of violence as per M.K. Gandhi. But this step of M.K. Gandhi was criticized heavily by many nationalists of India. Why? Because movement by now had become very successful. People were full of zeal and enthusiasm. People in Punjab had expected a lot from M.K. Gandhi. Because by now, M.K. Gandhi was not only a national leader. He was an international leader after his South African experiment. So basically, many leaders, they criticized the policy of M.K. Gandhi, and they said that when many Satyagrahis were arrested, when many Satyagrahis were beaten up in the police lockup, when many Satyagrahis died, M.K. Gandhi did not take the movement back. And now why he took the movement back when it was very successful? So many leaders criticized this act of M.K. Gandhi, and it is said that basically the movement's work came to an abrupt end, and M.K. Gandhi was put to jail for 6 years. Now, there was one section in the Congress party. They believed that we should participate in the election and we should wreck the working from within. Like, basically, they believed that if we boycott the legislative council, if we boycott the government school, we are doing our own, what we say, it is like putting, basically, we are going ourselves behind. Okay, we should participate in the election. We should win the election. And after winning the election, we will enter into the legislative council. And then we are going to frame rules and regulation. Then we are going to frame the policies which are in the favor of Indian administration and which is in the favor of Indians. So such was the thinking of one particular section of Indian National Congress. Now, this section was called as Swarajist or pro-changer, and the other section was called as no-changer. They believe that we do not want any change and we want the things to be continued in same fashion. Okay. So after this, there was creation of a new party, which is called as Swaraj Party, which in 1923 elections won 42 seats out of 104 seat. So it was a massive victory for a newly formed party for the first time. But later on, there was again division in the Swarajist rank, and finally Swarajists were again merged with the Indian National Congress on the insistence of M.K. Gandhi. So this was a brief background till what I have taught yesterday. Okay, guys? Yes, guys, please let me know, did you understand the background that I have discussed till now? Yes, Prerna. Yes, Royal. Don't worry. Even though you are attending my session for the first time, I'll try that. Basically, the things are clear in a systematic fashion. Okay, just listen keenly and patiently. Good evening, RJ. Good evening, Saimanshu. Okay, now let's quickly discuss. Today's lecture is a bit small one, guys. Let's quickly discuss Muddiman Committee. Okay. Now, Muddiman Committee, it was set up in 1924. Listen to me very carefully. It was set up in 1924 and it is also referred as Reforms Enquiry Committee. It is also referred as Muddiman Committee because the president or the chairman of the committee was Sir Alexander Muddiman. Okay. And this committee had four Indian members, which I have mentioned here. So what was the purpose of the Muddiman Committee? Let us understand in a very systematic fashion. Okay. Now, in the committee, there were certain British members and there were certain Indian members. The British members were called as official members and the Indian members were referred as non-official members. There were four Indian members and they were referred as non-official. And the British members of the Muddiman Committee were referred as officials. Okay. And officials were more in number in comparison to non-official. Now, what was the purpose of Muddiman Committee? Let us understand this in short. Now, there is an act which was passed in 1919. It is also called as Government of India Act 1919 or Montagu-Chelmsford Reform. It is referred as Montagu-Chelmsford Reform because Montagu was Secretary of State for India and Chelmsford was Viceroy of India. That is why Government of India Act 1919 was basically called as Montagu-Chelmsford Reform. Now, there are many clauses in the Government of India Act. And one of the clause was, as per Government of India Act 1919, diarchy was introduced in the provinces. Pay attention properly. Diarchy was introduced in the provinces and bicameralism was introduced at the center. Pay attention properly. For example, today we have parliament. In parliament, we have two houses, Lok Sabha and Rajya Sabha. This is called as bicameralism. And what is diarchy? This is at the center. And what is at the provinces? Diarchy was introduced. Provinces is synonymous with present day states. Isn't that so? Like we have state of Maharashtra, we have state of UP, we have state of Andhra, we have state of Karnataka and so on. So at that time, they were referred as provinces. So in provinces, diarchy was introduced. And what is diarchy? Rule of two. Di. Di means two. And who are these two? One is Governor General and his Executive Council. And the second one is Minister. I repeat, Governor General and his Council. And second one is Minister. So basically the rules and regulation. Basically the policies in the provinces were framed by two. One is Governor General and his Executive Council. And second is the Minister. Okay. Now listen to me very carefully. There were two subjects at that time. Reserved subject and transferred subject. The name itself suggests the reserved subjects were reserved for British officer. The reserved subjects were reserved for Governor General and his council. And transfer subjects were for the ministers. Reserved subjects were of national importance. And transferred subjects were of local importance. Okay? So this is called as a diarchy. Diarchy simply means rule of two, which was introduced during Montagu-Chelmsford reforms in the provinces. And now in 1924, that is 5 years later after the Montagu-Chelmsford reform, committee was formed. And the purpose of Muddiman committee was to review the working of diarchy. Okay? Now basically, as I have told you, in Muddiman committee, there were two members, official and the non-official. The British members were referred as official and the Indian members were referred as non-official. And there were four Indian members. Now, there was debate and discussion. There was analysis of the working of diarchy. And after that, non-officials came to conclusion that we needed a constitution on permanent basis. Like initially, Britishers had introduced Indian Council Act 1892. Then they introduced Morelamento reforms. Then they introduced Government of India Act 1990. But if we observe in all the three stages, the power of the Britishers hardly changed. In fact, their power came on increasing. Like it is said that it seems like Indians were given more power. But actually, Indians were not given that power. Why? I'll give you a very small example. Like more number of Indians were associated in the Imperial Legislative Council. More number of Indians were associated in the Provincial Legislative Council. But no power was given to them. Why? Because we can discuss the budget. We can go for debate and discussion. We can go for analysis. But the final authority lies with Governor General. If the final authority lies with the Governor General, what is the use of such power? Isn't that so? For example, if Britishers are spending more money on arms and ammunition rather than spending for welfare of the people, isn't that so? We can only discuss that you shouldn't spend more money on arms and ammunition. You should not conquer more territories. Rather than that, you should spend more money on the welfare like sanitation, education, infrastructure, irrigation, agriculture, health, and so on. We can just discuss this. But who is the final authority to pass this? Britishers. So now non-officials demanded that we want a permanent constitution through which our country could be administered and run in a very smooth manner. But finally, at that time, Secretary of State for India was Lord Birkenhead. And Lord Birkenhead said that whatever decisions that we are going to take, it would be completely on the basis of majority report. And as I have told you, in Muddiman committee, there were more Englishmen in comparison to Indians. And what will happen? Whatever decision would be taken, it would be taken in favor of the British officers. It would be taken in favor of the officials. Hope so the points are clear about the Muddiman committee. My friends, did you understand the Muddiman committee? Yes. Good evening, Madhavi. Good evening, Supriya. Yes, Sarfaraz. Correct. Yes, RJ. It's a funny name. Yes, guys. Did you understand this? Okay. Let's quickly go for Simon Commission. Let's understand about the Simon Commission again. Okay. Today's lecture would be over just within more 15-20 minutes. Okay. Now, what is Simon Commission all about? Let us understand this. Now, one of the clauses of Montagu-Chelmsford reforms was basically, after 10 years, one commission would be appointed. And the responsibility of that and the duty of that commission would be to review the working of entire Montagu-Chelmsford reform. Like basically, I have said, Government of India Act 1919 or Montagu-Chelmsford reform had one clause. And that clause was basically that after 10 years, we are going to appoint one commission. And the purpose of this commission was basically to review that whether the recommendations of Government of India Act 1919 are properly implemented or not. And if any changes are required in that act, basically. That was the purpose of a particular commission. So, a commission was appointed in 1927. And that commission was called as Simon Commission. It was called as Simon Commission because it was headed by Sir John Simon. And it had 7 people and all of them were Englishmen. Okay. Now at that point of time, Lord Birkenhead was a Secretary of State for India. And in fact, Lord Birkenhead and even Lord Irwin, both of them suggested that no Indian should be appointed in the Simon Commission. There shouldn't be any single Indian member in the Simon Commission. Now please pay attention and try to understand the analytical part of this. The commission is appointed to review the working in India and there is no single Indian member in it. So is there any logic behind that, guys? Hardly any Indian was involved. Can you understand this? An Indian is more aware about the grassroots realities of India. An Indian is more aware about the administrative conditions in India rather than the Englishmen. And these Englishmen are highly alien to the conditions of the people in India. How can they suggest logical reforms in India? So basically, they said that this commission was completely full of Englishmen. And this commission was heavily criticized. Why? Because it did not have a single Indian member. And this was an insult to the people of India. Like you are making law for us. You are framing the policies for us. New further administrative reforms would be introduced in India without the recommendations of Indian. So what sort of law are you imposing? And what you are showing basically that slowly with the passage of time, we are associating more number of Indians into the administration. Is this how you guys are introducing reforms in India? Like as we have discussed in Montagu Declaration, what was that declaration? That in a stage by stage manner, in a gradual manner, we are going to introduce more number of Indians in the administration. But you can see in the Simon Commission that it was completely full of Englishmen and hardly any Indian was there in the Simon Commission. Is this how you are serious about giving independence to India? Is this how you are associating more number of Indians in the administration? And in fact, Lord Irwin purposely kept Indians out of the administrations because he believed that Indians are not able to run their own administration properly. Like, basically, sometimes it is said that these mistakes were committed by our nationalists itself. Why? Initially, the Hindus and the Muslims were divided. Then moderates and the extremists were divided. Then the Swarajists and certain sections of Indian National Congress were divided. So Britishers right from the start had played a very wonderful game, and that was divide and rule and carrot and stick policy. And my friends, I have already told you, Britishers were expert in this policy. They have ruled India for more than 200 years just on these two policies. That is divide and rule and disturb the communal harmony of the nation, and carrot and stick policy. Carrot and stick basically means if you have to suppress one particular section of the society, you need to pacify the other section of the society. Okay? So, Simon Commission was a deliberate insult to the people of India. Now, what are the explicit and what are the implicit objectives of Simon Commission? Now, what is explicit and what is implicit? Explicit means these objectives are shown to the people of India that yes, we are serious in introducing more reforms in India. And what is implicit? Hidden intentions of the Britishers. So now let us understand this. Now, by not introducing any Indian member into the Simon Commission, this simply exemplifies one thing. Now, these people were not ready to transfer power at any cost. They were not in any consolidatory mood to give more power to the Indians. And one of the other reasons for Simon Commission was, as I've told you, one of the clauses was in Montagu Chelmsford reform. And second thing, non-cooperation movement had just ended. To fill up that gap, basically, they had introduced Simon Commission so that it could be shown to the Indians that, yes, we are sincere about introducing reforms in India. But this was not the actual case. Now, please understand the second provision properly. I'll read the second and the third provision so that you can easily understand. To further widen the communal feelings by diametric provision, which would further divide the two community. And the fourth provision, please, I'm reading this, pay attention properly. To give impression of a federal constitution so that weak center and powerful province can be created. Pay attention properly so that you can understand the concept. Today, we have a federal constitution, but we have a strong center and weak states, and the power is centralized in the hands of center. Basically, states have their own powers, which are exemplified through state list. Center has their own power. Okay? Powers are decentralized, but majorly the powers are held by the center. This is a case of a strong federalism. This is a case of a strong federal country. Now, how in a very systematic fashion the Britishers were sowing the seeds of communalism? Let us understand this. Now, more powers were designated to the provinces in comparison to the center. Now, what will happen? Province will become more powerful than the center. And now, basically, provinces will start demanding more and more powers for each other. Like, for example, there was United Province, there was Central Province, there was Bengal Province, basically, Assam Province. Okay? Now, power was increased for these provinces. Now, what will happen? There will be a rat race for more power. Now, what did Britishers do? In certain provinces, less powers would be designated. And in few provinces, more powers will be designated. So, what will happen accordingly? There would be a competition between the provinces. And this would divide the harmony of the people of India. So, these provisions, they are trying to divide the people of India. Now, what will happen? People will feel that these provinces are given more power. These provinces are given less power. Now, we also want more power. So, what will they do? They will start opposing the activities of other province and they will start supporting the activities of the Britishers so that more powers would be delegated to them. This will promote regionalism. People will start thinking more about their provinces rather than thinking about the entire nation. And this will make the work of the Britishers quite easier. Getting the points clear? This will make the work of the Britishers quite easier. It will promote a feeling of regionalism rather than nationalism. And regionalism is always an antidote to nationalism. What is nationalism? I have used two words basically initial in my previous lectures, state and the nation. What is state? State defines the political boundaries of any particular country. But what is nation? Feeling of belongingness towards one country. That is called as nation, nation or nationalism. So by promoting regionalism, they are trying to suppress the nationalism. And more powers and more autonomy would be given to the provinces. So what will happen? The center will become weak and the provinces will become strong. Getting the points clear? Can you understand how in a very systematic fashion, Britishers are trying to divide the integrity of India? They are trying to break the unity and the communal harmony in India. Yes, guys, did you understand the point still here? Please let me know. Yes, Monisha, I'll try to keep that. Yes, perfect, Satya. Britishers were more often involved in showing things rather than working upon it. You are correct. Yes, they wanted to keep their more domain intact, basically, Rituparna. That is why they did not associate Indians into it. Yes, Kiruba, basically the number of members, like few books suggest that there are approximately around 8 to 9 members, okay, in the commission. And it was chaired by whom? Sir Alexander Muddiman. Getting the points clear? Yes, Vaishali, second point. There would be a federal constitution. Federal means strong center and weak states. The power are devolving basically from the sea. Okay, I'll explain this point again. To further widen the communal feeling by diametric provision. What is like the things are? Try and understand this, Vaishali. It seems that more powers are given to Indian. Now what will happen? Provinces will be given power and there would be competition among the provinces for their further improvement. Now what will happen? This will promote regionalism. Regionalism means people want more power for their provinces. Okay. And not for the entire nation. And regionalism is completely going to kill the enthusiasm and the feeling of nationalism among the people. This is the meaning of the second statement. Hope so, Vaishali, I have made my point clear. Yes, RJ, like as I have told you, easily, in very simple words, how provinces are made stronger, let us understand this. By designating more power to the provinces. Like for example, like certain subjects are reserved with the Britishers and certain subjects are reserved with the Indians. Indian ministers, taking these power from them and designating these power to the Britishers. Okay. Secondly, in the provinces, like it is said that, I'll give you a very small example. There were reserved subject and transferred subject and the power was in the hand of Governor General. Decreasing the number of ministers. Okay. And increasing the number of Governor General and his Executive Council. Taking away the existing power of these people and giving it to the ministers in a very systematic fashion. So, it was not about the number. It was about the provisions that was included here. Hope so, RJ, I have made your point clear. Yes, RJ. Now, see, again, I am going to discuss this so that you can easily elaborate and understand that how provinces will be weakened. Now, let us understand this. There should be constitutional reconstruction. Now, as what are the recommendations basically? Now, Simon Commission completely analyzed the situation. Okay. Now, after analyzing the situation, they have seen that things that Indians were more active in the process of budget making. Indians were more active in the arguments and the debates that were held in the Imperial Legislative Council and Provincial Legislative Council. And Indians feel that basically no powers are designated to them. So what did they suggest? There is a need for constitutional reconstruction. We again need to change the act, we again need to make certain amendments in Government of India Act 1919. First recommendation. Second recommendation, there should be a federal constitution. Federal basically means that power should be shared between the center and the state, and there should be harmony in both of them. But here, basically, true federalism, what does true federalism means? Strong center and weak provinces. But here the case was exactly reverse. Strong provinces and weak center. This will promote regionalism and divide the entire country. Provinces should be given full autonomy. Then, now see, the fourth clause, it is self-explanatory. And basically, fourth clause exemplifies the flaw of Simon Commission. What is that flaw? Governor should have the discretionary power related to internal security and administrative powers. Now listen to me very carefully. What is discretionary power? These are certain powers which can be taken by the governor without any permission from anyone. Okay? Like in very simple words, there are certain powers which are designated to President of India. President of India can take action on these powers. President of India can use this power according to his will. These are discretionary powers of the president. Similarly, Governor General at that time was given certain discretionary power. Like although these basically subjects are mentioned in reserve list, these subjects are mentioned in transferred list. Although if the Governor General feel that if I have to make a law on a particular subject which is mentioned in transferred list, I can make a law on that. Why? Because it is a discretionary power of that governor. And what reason can be cited? Name itself suggests, my friends, transferred subject. Transferred means any time these subjects could be transferred to the Britishers. Any time Britishers can make law on these subject. And it was based upon the discretion of whom? It was based upon the discretion of Governor, Viceroy and Secretary of State. Now, is this a sort of constitutional reconstruction? Are you giving more power to Indians or are you taking the existing one? Okay, number of members of provincial legislative council should be increased. Like we have discussed earlier that there were, depending upon the population of the provinces, the number of members were, Indians were there in that provinces. But now can you understand one important aspect? Although you are going to increase the number of Indians, but if they are not given the power to vote, if they are not given the power to frame rules and regulation law according to their own will, basically, then how can you say that you are designating more power to the Indians? Like I'll give you a very simple example. Britishers are practicing colonialism. They are conquering new territories in the name of colonialism. They are exploiting the new places and the people of that region. Okay? They are driving out the entire resources of India. They are driving out the money from India. Okay? And now what they want? They want Indians to support on them. So how can we support in these policies basically? So it is a part like we are not practicing colonialism. We want welfare of our own nation. We want development in our own nation. We want the problems to be resolved in our country. We want sincere transfer of power. But the final power is in the hands of Britishers. And Britishers are hardly sincere about their aim. Okay? Then, Governor General should have complete power to appoint the members of cabinet. I'll give you a very small example. I'll now understand this. Suppose there is a Bombay Presidency. In Bombay Presidency, I'm giving an example so that you can easily understand. Suppose in Bombay Presidency, there are 50 members. Out of 50 members, 25 are Indians and 30 are Indians and 20 are Britishers or nominated members who are nominated by the Britishers. Now what will happen? There would be Council of Ministers created. And in the Council of Ministers, there would be a cabinet which would be taking the decision. And who is going to appoint the members of the cabinet? Governor General. And actually, who should appoint the members of the cabinet? It should be decided by the consensus. Isn't that so? All 50 members should decide among themselves. Or the speaker of that council should decide the members of the cabinet. But who is going to decide here? Governor General. And obviously, Governor General is going to place those members in the cabinet who are loyal to the Britishers. Isn't that so? So it seems that we are given power, but actually we were not given powers. In fact, our existing powers were taken away by the Britishers in a very systematic manner. Okay? Then, Government of India should have complete control over the High Court. Listen to me. Court is a place which is considered as temple of justice in India right from the ancient times. Now, basically, there should be separation of judiciary and executive. And one of the major, there are two types of executive right from the start itself we have seen. One is political executive and other is permanent executive. Political executives are the ministers who frame rules and regulation, who frame the policies. And permanent executive are the officers who implement or execute these policy. Now, are these laws in favor of the people? Are these laws in the favor of the nation and the society? Who is going to interpret this? The court is going to interpret this. And until and unless complete authority, complete autonomy is given to the court in its functioning, it cannot function in a smooth manner and deliver proper justice. And if there is a continuous interference by the government in the working of the court, hardly, basically, court will have any authority for judicial interpretation. Similarly, here, the entire power of the court was taken by the government of India, that is by the British government. So what is court left with? Hardly any powers. So these were the recommendations of Simon Commission. Now, what are the limitations basically? As I've discussed previously, that it had 7 members and there was no single Indian member in the commission. You are coming in India for constitutional reconstruction. You are coming in India to frame rules and regulations for Indian. You are coming in India to frame new administrative policy for India. And no single Indian member is involved in this. Are Englishmen more aware about the grassroots realities of India, or a local Indian leader is more aware about the grassroots realities? Obviously, a local Indian leader is more aware about the grassroots realities of our nation. And here, they have completely neglected the Indians in the commission. Then, no universal franchisee was proposed. Like, listen to me. One of the clauses of Government of India Act 1919 or Montagu-Chelmsford reforms was, any person whose taxable income is Rs. 3000, in very simple words, in very simple language, anybody who is paying a tax of more than Rs. 3000 has the right to vote. So very few people had the right to vote at that time. And Simon Commission did not work upon this. In fact, universal franchise should be introduced. A particular criteria of age should be decided. And after that, everyone has the authority to vote irrespective of the religion, irrespective of the gender, irrespective of the caste and class. But Simon Commission did not work upon this issue. Position of Governor General remained unaffected. I'll give you a very small comparative analysis so that you can easily understand this. Indian Council Act 1892 was introduced. As per that act, Indian ministers can discuss the budget, but they cannot vote upon the budget. And the final authority to pass the budget was in the hand of Governor General. Then came Morelam into reform. More number of Indians were included in the administration. The seats in the Imperial Legislative Council and the Provincial Legislative Council was increased. Indians can discuss the budget. Indians can ask supplementary question. They can be part of debate and discussion and analysis, but they cannot vote upon the budget. Still, the power of Governor General remained the same. There was hardly any change in the power of Governor General. Then came basically Government of India Act 1919. Same year again, there were subjects being created, bicameralism was introduced, diarchy was introduced, more number of Indians were included in the administration, but finally, the authority was in the hand of Secretary of State for India, Viceroy and Governor. Is this how they were diluting the powers to Indian? Then, no provision to abolish separate electorate. Listen to me very carefully, this point. We'll try and analyze this statement. Listen to me. Like, as per Morley Minto Reforms 1909, separate electorate was introduced for Muslim section. I'll give you a small example. Like in Imperial Legislative Council, as per Morley Minto Reforms, 60 seats were there, 6-0. Out of this, 33 were nominated and 27 were elected. Among 27, okay, 8 were reserved for Muslim. So for the first time, as per Morley Minto Reforms, basically, reservation for minority was introduced. Then in the Government of India Act 1919, this separate electorate clause was extended to other community. Like it was extended to Sikh, it was extended to Parsi, Anglo-Indian, Europeans and the depressed class. Getting the points clear? Now what happened basically here? They are again trying to divide the people by going for allocation of seat. In this manner, they are trying to divide the entire nation. I'll give you a very small example. Okay. Suppose I am a Muslim leader. I am working for my country. Okay. Right from my start itself, I am working for my country. I do not require any separate electorate here. Why? Because if I am working for my nation, if I am working for my people, I do not require separate electorate. Even the Hindus are going to elect me, even the Muslims are going to elect me, even the Sikh are going to elect me, and even the Anglo-Indians are going to elect me. Why? Because I am working for the cause of nation. And what does separate electorate means? Separate electorate means simply exemplifies that there is a division of the society. And this will make the work of basically Britishers quite easier. And finally, can you see any power was given to Indian? Hardly any powers were given to Indians basically. Okay. Yes, my friends, did you get the points? Did you understand these aspects? Please let me know. Any doubt, any query, any question till now? Yes, Rituparna, all the recommendations were completely in favor of the Britishers. And in very simple words, Britishers just wanted to show that, see, that we have brought a commission basically and we are sincere about our goals to give independence. Hope so, Rituparna, I have answered your question. Yes, Harmeet, a mirage for Indians basically. Yes, RJ, like the all the power were kept with them and hardly Indians were given any sort of responsibility. Yes, perfect prince, like the French monarchy at that time. Okay. Now let's understand about the reaction of the various group against the commission. Now, in 1927, Madras session of Indian National Congress, which was presided by M.A. Ansari, it was decided to boycott the Simon Commission at each and every stage and every form. And it was supported by every section of the Indian society except few. Okay. Now listen to this concept very clearly. Now it is said that liberals of Hindu Mahasabha, like initially Pandit Madan Mohan Malviya. Madan Mohan Malviya ji is associated with Hindu Mahasabha. Okay. He was not supportive of the policies initially of the Congress because he did not like the working pattern of the Congress initially. But now he was very supportive of boycotting the Simon Commission. Because first of all, it did not had any Indian member. And secondly, hardly any new reforms were introduced by the Simon Commission. So what is the use of this commission basically? Okay, so in fact, Hindu Mahasabha, Congress and even certain section of the Muslim League were opposing the Simon Commission. But now listen to me very carefully. In Muslim League, there were two views. Now, as I have told you, like the Indian National Congress, there was another party which was called as All India Muslim League. And like the Indian National Congress, All India Muslim League met every year and discussed the issues of national importance and the issues of Muslim interest basically. So what happened? In 1927, Muslim League conducted two sessions. One session was in Calcutta and the other session was in Lahore. The session at Calcutta was presided by Muhammad Ali Jinnah. And the session at Lahore was presided by Muhammad Shafi. Now, in the first session of Muslim League, which was held at Calcutta and presided by Muhammad Ali Jinnah, it was decided that Muslims should give up separate electorate. And if they are giving up separate electorate, this will project Hindu-Muslim unity in the eyes of the Britishers. Okay? And secondly, in the second session, which was presided by Muhammad Shafi, I've told you, okay, it was said that Muslims are not going to give up the practice of separate electorate. Because since we have a separate seat for us, we can work for educational, economic and social upliftment of the Muslim. This was felt by Muhammad Shafi, who presided the session at Lahore. Now, what happened basically? The Safi section of the Muslim League supported the Simon Commission. And Muhammad Ali Jinnah's section of the Muslim League supported boycott of Simon Commission. And there were many who were boycotting the Simon Commission. And there were many who were supporting the Simon Commission. Like Muslim League, which was headed by Muhammad Shafi, was supporting the Simon Commission. Certain loyalists in Punjab were supporting the Simon Commission. Depressed classes led by B.R. Ambedkar was supporting the Simon Commission. Okay? So these and Europeans were supporting the Simon Commission. Hindu Mahasabha, Muslim League led by Muhammad Ali Jinnah, and basically Congress, they were boycotting the Simon Commission. What happened basically? When Simon Commission arrived in India at Bombay in 1928, and wherever Simon Commission went, it was greeted with black flag throughout the India and one slogan throughout entire India. Rather it be Bombay, rather it be Lahore, rather it be Vijayawada, rather it be Pune, rather it be Calcutta. One slogan throughout the entire India, and that is Simon, go back. Wherever he was going basically, he was greeted with black flag and the slogan of Simon, go back. Two major leaders of the youth emerged at this time, Jawaharlal Nehru and Subhash Chandra Bose. Initially, the goal of the Indian National Congress was, we want independence in a gradual and a stage by stage manner. But now Jawaharlal Nehru and Subhash Chandra Bose had sensitized the youth throughout the nation. And the goal was complete independence. We do not want to keep any relation with the Britishers, and we want complete detachment from the British rule. And Jawaharlal Nehru was very successful in sensitizing the masses about the complete independence. No dominion status, no self-government. Complete detachment from the British rule and complete Indianization of the administration was the goal by now after the arrival of Simon Commission. Punjab Naujawan Bharat Sabha, created by Bhagat Singh, then Hindustan Seva Dal in Karnataka, it played a major role in sensitizing the masses here. What happened? Basically, government came up heavily on the demonstrators. As usual, Britishers are always ready for a brutal suppression of any movement. They were ready with the lathi charge, and one important incident occurred here. Lala Lajpat Rai ji was protesting in Punjab, basically, against the arrival of Simon Commission. And during the protest, during the demonstration, there were many lathi blows on his chest, which it is said that it probably became the reason for Lala Lajpat Rai ji's death. And basically, the revenge for the death of Lala Lajpat Rai was taken by basically this person, Bhagat Singh ji. And Bhagat Singh ji, he killed basically J.P. Saunders. He killed Scott. These are the SP and DSP who are in Punjab. Okay. These people were involved in the murder of Lala Lajpat Rai during the lathi charge. And Bhagat Singh took the revenge at that time. This we are going to study when we are going to study about the revolutionaries. Okay. Hope so, my friends, the Simon Commission are clear. Hope so, the doubts are clear. Yes, Bhagat Singh ji, Chandrasekhar Azad, Rajguru, Ashfaq Ullah Khan, Ram Prasad Bismil, Durga Bhabi, these are the leaders of the youth. And we can see, although they were revolutionaries in their thought, we cannot say that these people, they believed in the progress of the nation. Like many people say, listen to me very carefully. I have read about Bhagat Singh ji in detail quite depth. Many people say that Bhagat Singh Ji was a revolutionary, and Britishers have given a very derogatory term, that is revolutionary terrorist, to them. But Bhagat Singh Ji was an expert person in economics. Such a dynamic personality with huge knowledge of economics and political science. Can you understand? It is said that there is an incident, like on the day when Bhagat Singh Ji was given, he was going to the gallows, like when he was hanged to death, he was reading Bhagavad Gita. And like a person came in, he was reading a particular book, a particular mythological book. And when a person came in and asked him basically, yes, you come to the gallows now. He said that just give me a few minutes, let me complete this page. Okay. It is said that his mother never came to see him in the last time, because he said that my Azadi, like it is said that he was never married throughout his life. And what did he say basically, Bhagat Singh Ji? Azadi hi meri dulhan hai. What is that? Freedom is my wife. These are the leaders. Basically, they were devoted to the nation. Not saying that the others were not, but everyone had played a major and dynamic role in sensitizing the masses. Isn't that so? Yes. Yes, Harmeet, you want me to explain the limitations of Simon Commission? Okay. I have explained properly. Listen to me. First limitation, there was hardly any Indian member in the Simon Commission. Although the commission was introduced to bring reforms in India, but hardly there was any Indian in the commission. Okay. Getting the points clear? First limitation. Second major limitation, it seems that more reforms were introduced for Indians, but actually no reforms were introduced. Third, they were trying to divide the people and the country. How? Basically, like they were promoting regionalism by giving more power to the provinces in comparison to the center. Rather than making center strong and the provinces weak, they were making the provinces strong and the center weak. This was trying to divide the country basically. Okay? There was no discussion on giving more power to vote for the people. There was no dilution in the powers of Governor General. These are the major limitations of the Simon Commission. Hope so, Harmeet, I have answered your question. Please let me know. Yes, Amiya. Bhagat Singh Ji and Sukhdev organized Lahore Student Union. Perfect. See, RJ, Subhash Chandra Bose came into the active politics along with Jawaharlal Nehru, and he came up as a leader of the youth. Okay? And he played a very major role after 1935. We are going to study about Subhash Chandra Bose Ji also in detail. Hope so, RJ, I have made my point clear. Yes. Now let's understand Butler Committee very fast. See, along with the Simon Commission, British appointed a 3-member committee, which was also referred as Butler Committee. And it is called as Butler Committee because Sir Harcourt Butler was the chairman of this committee. Okay. You know about this. There is an institute in the name of Butler Committee in Kanpur, HBTI Kanpur. Have you heard about this? Harcourt Butler Technical Institute. You know about this, guys? There is an institute in his name. Okay. So Sir Harcourt Butler was a chairman of the Butler Committee. And other members were S.C. Peel and Holdsworth. And what was the purpose of basically the Butler Committee? See, we have studied about subsidiary alliance system, which was started by Lord Wellesley. As per subsidiary alliance system, Britishers were called as paramount power and the princely states were called as basically protected state. Getting the points clear? Now, basically, they wanted to analyze basically the British India's relation with the princely state. Now, listen to me very carefully. By now, the masses were full of enthusiasm and zeal. By now, all the sections of Indian society, all the sections of the Indian leaders were sensitized for their independence. And there were many rising leaders after the non-cooperation movement and arrival of Gandhi. So what happened? Britishers had expected something, and that is princely states to be loyal to them. And to understand the relation between the princely state and the British India, a committee was appointed called as Butler Committee. Now, this committee visited 16 princely states and it submitted its report in 1929. And these were the recommendations given by the Butler Committee. Now, we have seen Revolt of 1857. We have seen basically the Swadeshi movement. We have seen Home Rule League movement. We have seen the non-cooperation movement. We have seen the activities of Swarajist. We have discussed few revolutionary. But hardly any princely states were participant in these movement because princely states at that time were loyal to the Britishers. And basically, here they gave one recommendation that paramountancy must remain supreme. It simply means that Britishers should remain supreme to the princely state. Princely states can carry on their own internal affairs. But princely states cannot befriend the other European powers without the permission of the Britishers. Finally, the paramountancy of the British should remain intact. First recommendation. The states would not be transferred without agreement with the new government in British India responsible to Indian legislature. Listen to me. Even if certain steps are taken for changes in the constitution in India, even if certain steps are taken for new developments in India, okay, until and unless princely states agrees for that, and until and unless that agreement is also accepted by the Britishers, the power would not be transferred to them. Okay, then Viceroy and the Governor General was to be the crowned agent dealing in the state. Listen to me. After Government of India Act 1858, the rule of company in India was replaced by rule of crown. And the rule of crown was basically practiced by Secretary of State for India. Secretary of State for India was a member of British cabinet and he was a part of the British member of parliament. Okay. He was exercising the powers in India. Now these princely states are going to interact directly with the Viceroy and the Secretary of State for India. They are not going to interact with any other authorities in India. Directly they are going to interact with Viceroy and the Secretary of State for India. And they said that basically to appease the princely state, to keep the support of princely states intact, they said that the relation between the princely states and the British India is not a contractual relationship. We have not entered into a contract basically. This Britishers are saying why? Because they can garner the support of princely state. In very simple words, to a sort of makhan polish to the basically princely state. And what they are saying, we are having a good relation because not because we are in a contract, but because we have adopted to each other needs and policies in the exigencies of time. In very simple words, they were buttering the princely states so that when every section of the Indian society is opposed to the policies of the Britishers, princely states are going to stand with the Britishers. So these were the major recommendations of the Butler Committee. So my friends, did you understand Butler Committee? Did you understand Simon Commission? And did you understand Muddiman Committee? Yes, please let me know. Abhinav, agar aap UPSC ke exam nahi dete ho, to wo attempt nahi gina jayega. Even though if you have filled a form, agar aapne form fill bhi kiya hai, phir bhi attempt nahi gina jayega. Agar aap appear nahi karte ho to. Okay? Yes guys, did you understand the concept? Yes, Sarfaraz. Sonali, usually the timing for the online class on YouTube is at 7 p.m. Okay. Yes, one more reminder. Tomorrow at 9:15 a.m. in the morning on the Unacademy platform, I would be conducting a special class on the Mauryans. Those who haven't attended my sessions basically on the Mauryans, basically, they can attend it. Okay. So please do come for the special class at 9:15 in the morning. Please write down today's question. Yes, hope so, guys. Everyone is practicing answer writing at home in a very serious manner. Hold on for a second. Write down the question for the day. Yes. Simon Commission exemplified the non-seriousness of Britishers in transferring power to Indians. I repeat, Simon Commission exemplified the non-seriousness of the Britishers in transferring power to the Indians. You have to write this answer in 150 words. Okay? The answer should be completed just within 6.5 minutes. Please stick to the time limit so that you will develop that practice. Okay? Yes. Yes, I will share it. Okay. Thank you, guys. Thanks a lot. Please do subscribe to Unacademy and use my code AKOUS. I repeat, please do subscribe to Unacademy and use my code AKOUS. Thank you very much.